Without Nehemiah, I probably wouldn't be able to sleep at night, knowing that my son was probably still be out on the streets.
Why should they care? Why should John Doe care about the men of Nehemiah? I like to say the longer something falls, the faster it falls. And in this country today, the proliferation of drugs is crazy. The demographics here at the men of Nehemiah, the kids are getting younger and younger that walk through this door. Kids are doing drugs today at 8, 9, 10 years old. And you don't get to choose if it's your kid or not. I don't care how well you raise them. I don't care what you give them or do for them or how educated they are.
Drug addiction has no insight to socioeconomic status, bank account balance, how you were brought up. It can fail anybody.
So when you get involved with stuff like this, I'm not saying it insulates you, but it humbles you before the mighty hand of God.
He was a good student in school. So as soon as he got home, he wanted to do his homework and get it over with because he wanted to go play. He didn't even want a snack. He wanted to get his homework done so he can go play. When he had his 19th birthday, when I think that's when he started experimenting with stuff that he didn't need to be.
Nothing's that important until it affects you, until it affects your household, because you don't know what's happening tomorrow in your life or in your children's life. I can tell you, once God changes a heart, I mean, man, we're not talking about perfection, we're talking about progress.
I attended the Men of Nehemiah in 2013 for the first time. I think that was the first time I heard God speak to me, like, very directly. He told me, you haven't been doing the right thing, and I felt it. It's just something I felt that was deeply intense that I can't even put into words.
I didn't want God. I was so angry and so bitter and so frustrated about the way that I had grown up, that why would God want somebody as broken as me? But that's what he uses. He uses broken sticks to make a straight path.
There's a misconception of addiction, that addiction only happens to the dregs of society. Nothing really could be farther from the truth. These people have been conditioned, many of these men, in unfathomable circumstances that has stacked the odds against them so greatly.
Addiction is found in 1 out of every 10 Americans. It's like trying to walk forward with your head backwards. You know you're supposed to be going this direction, but all you can see is confusion.
My mentee, within 30 seconds of our first, formal meeting, he's literally telling me about being raped by multiple family members. In many respects, men find their ways into addiction just by way of trying to survive. Many of these men have almost been predisposed, if you will, to make bad decisions.
When I was about 18 years old, my mother overdosed, and my addiction went haywire. 2009, I tried to kill myself. I drank a gallon of antifreeze.
He said, Mom, I know I look bad. I said, yeah, but you're gonna get better.
Our statistics show that 69% of those men stay clean and sober for the next 2 years.
See, Nehemiah, they work on so many levels. First, you come in the program, you're quarantined for about 4 to 5 days where you can let the drugs kind of subside out your system. And they give you things to memorize, like biblical principles. So your memory is starting to pick up again. And the physical activities we do, PT, you have to do push-ups, you have to do jumping jacks twice a week. And then you have biblical, so you're getting fed physically, mentally, spiritually. It's a tight community, so you have to hold your brothers accountable.
It teaches them how to get rid of all the pain and suffering that they've gone through.
His speech changed. His attitude changed.
It teaches them to let go of their past and become men.
Building you up as an individual, as a man to be restored to his family.
And it teaches them how to be men of God.
The redemption is a relationship with Christ. And that's really what this place affords people, that opportunity to get that time to experience God's love, to experience communal love from a community that clearly cares about them. And that's when miracles happen.
He's a man now. He's grown up a lot. He calls me and encourages me and give me scriptures and, well, Mama, you got to think about this and think about, and he's just a totally different man. I mean, I like the Daniel that I see today.
Whatever will be, it will be. Won't let the weight of this world bury me. We all want our place in the sun. Come whatever one may, it is done.
I want to take this time to sincerely thank everyone who attended our fundraiser event. Just your continued giving, your giving this night and your giving in the past has been the reason why we continue to exist. So just a heartfelt a gratitude that I have for you guys, and I'm sincerely humbled and sincerely grateful.
A beautiful world.